Jonathan, what have we got in the inbox today?
All right, Kim, let's see what we got kicking in here. Here's one that's slightly outside of my comfort zone. The customer is kind of asking about doing larger molecule analysis. Their lab's moving from, say, small mol to peptides.
Oh.
And they want to know if they can treat peptides the same as they treat small mol in their workflows.
You know what? That's a great question. More and more groups we've seen have moved from small molecules to peptides or proteins. And it can be kind of confusing, you know, thinking about how you might have to change your analysis to handle these, you know, biomolecules.
Yeah, I mean, what's the biggest difference between, say, small mol and large molecules?
There are a lot of differences, but let me give you an idea just to start with.
Great.
So if you think about a small molecule, Jonathan, they're actually pretty much what it sounds like. They're small molecules, generally under 1,000 molecular weight. When we start thinking about things like peptides, now they're starting to get a little bit bigger. Hmm. You know, generally around 1 to 4,000 molecular weight, we're looking in a, you know, kind of a regular size peptide range. But then you start talking about proteins and they get quite large, as you can see with this monoclonal antibody. You definitely have to treat these molecules differently when you're doing chromatography.
Yeah, it's obvious to see the complexity too here, Kim. Boy, I mean, the small molecule, not that complex. That protein or antibody, woof, that thing is ginormous.
It is. It's going to behave very differently.
In testing for this myth, Kim, I think it might be really important to take a look at some Vandeemter curves, because with small molecules, you can run pretty fast. You can run up to maybe 800 microliters a minute without losing a lot of efficiency. It'd be nice to know if that holds true for these larger molecules. So do you think we should set up an experiment like that?
Yeah, I think what we can do is pick a particle size. Let's do 3.5 micron particle size.
Perfect.
And then run a variety of compounds with different molecular weights from small to larger. And then we can see what those Vandeemter curves look like to see where the optimal flow rates are. And we can get an idea if we have to treat the larger molecules differently than the smaller molecules.
That sounds perfect, Kim. I love doing Vandeemter curves. Let me run the first batch. That's totally in my comfort zone.
Okay. We can also think about particle size. And we can run maybe a peptide around 25 or 3,500 molecular weight.
Okay.
And then we can look at 3.5 micron versus 1.7 micron to see if the particle size has any influence on that molecular weight as well.
Cool. Because for small molecule, it would, but I'm not too sure about peptides.
Mm.
So that'll be neat. That'll be neat to see.
Let's see what the data shows us.
All right, great.
Okay.
So Kim, thanks a lot for letting me run these Vandeemter curves. I really like to run them. They're right in my wheelhouse of things that I actually like to do. So if you look at these four curves here, we're looking at analytes of four different molecular weights from 300 all the way to 4,500. We're looking at a flow range from say less than 100 microliters a minute up to say 500 microliters a minute. And based on these curves, you can see that for the smaller analyte, the molecular weight 300, it's really flat, which means you don't lose a lot of efficiency on column. But when you go to a larger molecule, boy, if you increase the flow rate, you're going to lose a lot of efficiency, and your peaks are going to get a little bit wider or even a lot wider, and that might not be advantageous. So that's one big difference between small molecule and large molecule separations. So Kim, you were able to look at the difference in particle size specifically for one peptide. How'd those results come out?
Sure. Well, we made a Vandeemter curve to look at the difference of a 2,500 molecular weight peptide on 3.5 micron particles versus 1.7 micron particles. And it's pretty clear from these curves that with the 1.7 micron particle, you can get much better performance, not only in efficiency, but it also gives you a wider range of flow rate from which to choose to get that improved efficiency.
So Kim, what does that Vandeemter curve look like for a real sample?
Right, so let's hone in on flow rate specifically. When we think about small molecules, you know, as we showed in the Vandeemter curves, it's very different with a peptide. So if we look at a peptide standard and we run that at 300 microliters a minute versus 100 microliters a minute, you can see the difference in the peak volume of the actual peaks of the peptide standard. So if we look at 300 microliters a minute versus 100 microliters a minute, you'll see that the peak volumes measured in microliters of each of those peptides is smaller at the slower flow rate. That speaks to the fact that these peptides will diffuse more slowly through the column for the chromatography. And really, again, we can't treat them like small molecules. We have to take a slower flow rate into consideration.
So Kim, based on the experiments that we've run, you know, there is a difference between larger molecules and smaller molecules, particularly in the flow rate. With small molecules, you can run, again, up to about 800 microliters a minute. With these peptides, we're down to about 400 microliters. That's half the flow.
Right. Yeah, we generally recommend that with a peptide, you start around 0.4 microliters per minute. You might need to go slower than that. The other important consideration is to think about the percentage of organic in your gradient. With peptides, you really don't want to go over 75% acetonitrile.
Now, why is that?
Because at a higher percentage of acetonitrile, you actually start to precipitate your peptides, which can cause you problems in reproducibility, it can cause carryover, and it can lead to problems in your chromatography.
That makes sense.
Yeah, definitely.
So getting back to the original myth, you know, do you have to run your samples differently when doing larger molecule analysis versus smaller molecule analysis? How do you want to call this one?
Well, I think we showed through the Vandeemter curves and the actual peptide standard sample, you definitely have to treat them differently. So that is trusted.
Yeah, I agree. Trusted, too. You just can't be performing your large mol separations like you do your small mol.
Right.
There are differences.
Right.
Do you want to write them up and get back to them?
Sure, I will. If you'd like your question to be answered on a future episode, please feel free to email us at trustyourscience@waters.com.